Well, I'd like to say I'm pleased to be here, and I'm really glad that you're here. And I don't know exactly where we're going tonight, so if I say anything that you don't agree with, that's just what it is. We just don't agree. But I'll start with some poems, and then we'll see. In the reality of many realities, how we see what we see affects the quality of our reality. We are children of earth and sky. DNA, descendant, now ancestor. Human being, physical spirit. Bone, flesh, blood as spirit. Metal, mineral, water as spirit. We are in time and space, but we're from beyond time and space. The past is part of the present. The future is part of the present. Life and being are interwoven. We are the DNA of Earth, Moon, planets, stars. We are related to the universal, Creator created creation, spirit and intelligence with clarity. Being and human as power. We are a part of the generations of evolution. We are a part of the memories. These memories carry knowledge. These memories carry our identity. Beneath race, gender, class, age. Beneath citizen, business, state, religion. We are human being. And these memories are trying to remind us, human beings, human beings. It is time to rise up. Remember who we are. Famine in the plenty. Patience burns quick. Waiting for the rich, but the rich won't hurry. The rich eat us, so the rich don't worry. In the sun's shadow, water melts into cold, running rivers of want. Want needs justice, but justice is just ice in those rivers of want. The stars in the night have seen it all. What isn't remembered takes time to weep. The soul isn't empty, yet it feels that way. Confusion in the happy place. The great lie is one with all the little lies, edges of breaking dreams cutting into other dreams. I want to talk a little bit about who we are, because I think the coherency of our future depends upon us knowing who we are, and I mean truly understanding who we are. Because our relationship to reality and our relationship to power is based upon that understanding. But sometimes I feel like I'm in a reality where we don't remember who we are, so therefore we don't know who we are. We speak a language we don't understand, and because of this we don't know where we are. And I think that we live in a technologic reality, that these conditions are the result of a mining process. I'm going to call it a mining process. And there's a reason we are in this situation, but it's got to do with being fed upon by a system. So I want to go to who we are. See, we're the human beings. And it's very important because we all know how to say the words. We know the terms. I know we know the terms because they taught them to us. They programmed this to us. And the words, human beings. But our relationship to reality is in that definition. So human. The bone, flesh, and blood. The DNA of the human. The bone, flesh, and blood is literally made up of the metals, minerals, and liquids of the earth. So we are parts of the earth. We are shapes of the earth. We're forms of the earth. This is the form that we are. All of the things of the earth have the same DNA as the human does. Everything of the earth has the same DNA as the human. Everything is made up of the metals, minerals, and liquids of the earth, but the shape is just different. And the purpose is different. And being, we have being. That's our essence, that's our spirit. And all of the things of the earth have the same DNA as the human has, so all the things of the earth have being. Spirit. And our relationship to power and reality is in that understanding of who we are. We are forms of the earth, and that's reality. Nothing will ever change that reality. What has changed is our perceptional relationship to reality. And what has happened to us through the millennium and through this whole technologic perception of reality, what has happened to the human beings is that, to me, it's like a disease in one way. It's like this thing just kind of spreads. And as it diseases the spirit of the people, it affects the perception of reality. So in one way, it's kind of like that. It's like a possession. But in another way, it's almost like a mechanical thing, this mining process that takes place. And it's almost like this thing that they call technologic civilization, see, is predatory upon our lives. Anybody ever feel something's missing from their life? Like purpose or understanding or self-worth or self, whatever the deal is, they're mining us. All right, they're mining us. And one of the objectives of this whole technologic civilized perceptional reality has got to do with erasing the memories of the human beings. Because we have a common collective experience. We are all the descendants of tribes. Back in the time of the original dream, see, we were all tribes and we were all the earth's children and we all knew that the earth was our mother and that we were a part of a spiritual reality, see, because we had being. We understood that there was a spiritual reality and we were physical in a spiritual reality. We being who we are today, however we landed in this reality, whoever we are today, we carry the genetic experience of our lineage from the very beginning. It's encoded in the DNA. It's like a genetic memory. Something about the experience of the journey. We have it in us. It's like... But anyway, within our genetic memories, somewhere hidden in there, we all come from a people. Every one of us comes from a people that understood that we lived in a spiritual reality. And because we lived in a spiritual reality, every one of our beginning ancestral peoples understood that life was about responsibility. So we were responsible for the past and the future as well as the present. And we understood that all things had being. So we knew who we were, we understood what we were saying, and we knew where we were, we knew our purpose. And this reality lives in our genetic memory, because see, as human beings, whoever we are, the individuals we are now, that experience is there. It's that 90% of the brain they tell us we can't use. So they're using it. We all understand that in this technologic reality that we live, this technologic dimensional reality that we live in, we understand that they can take the DNA of the earth that is called uranium in that shape and form. So they can take that DNA of the earth that is uranium, and it has being, spirit, and they can take it from the earth and they put it through a mining refinement process and convert the being part of that uranium into a form of energy, electrical energy, that they call power. And in a way it is power, but in reality it's a mutated form of power. And after they do this kind of a process, then we know that there's toxic waste and that there's poison left over from it. And we know they do it with fossils. Take that old dinosaur DNA and put it through the mining refining process and convert the being of that DNA into a form of energy that runs, again, another electrical system. And that also leaves behind its pollutions and its things. See, so I think that they're doing it to us. Because we come from the same reality, we're made up of the same thing. Our shape is different. That's all. Our shape and our function is different because our shape is different. But you come down to the genetic makeup of all of it, or the majority of water. But water has metals in it, and it has minerals in it. See, but I think as a part of that reality, see, that we're being mind. The being part of human is being mind. It's being mind by a perception of reality. And the people who enforce that perception of reality by indoctrinating it into every generation of human beings that is born. See, so to me, one of the purposes of this technologic perceptional civilization is that we are the fuel that runs it. And the poison, the toxic that is left over from the mining of the being part of human through the human, through the intelligence of the human. All right, all the fears and doubts and insecurities that we have in our lives within our own personal reality about who we are, the things that others don't see, that's the pollution and the toxic left over from the mining of the being part of human. That's the pollution that's left over, see, because in that kind of a haze, see, we don't see ourselves clearly. We do not see and recognize clearly who we are, and we're never encouraged to. We're encouraged to be good citizens or good this religion or good that religion or good, you know, good workers, good, yeah. But we're never encouraged to be real about human beings. In a way, we're never really encouraged to be good to ourselves. See, we're mentally and psychologically oppressed and manipulated so that we seek things to gratify ourselves, but that doesn't mean we bring good to ourselves. And the mining process, to me, you know, it's the civilizing process itself. Because somewhere in there, it's like someone's eating spirit. Our spirit is being converted into an energy to run something. All right, and it's like it's eating our spirit. See, and, you know, everyone has their religions and their stuff. See, but it makes me wonder, how do we participate in this spiritual reality? If we live in a mechanism now where the human has been conditioned and trained to eat its own spirit and turn it into fuel for the system. So life was about responsibility. And the earth was the mother. And at some point in the evolution of the human beings, another perception of reality appeared. And this perception of reality, it took the spirit away from the animals and all of the other things, and it started changing spirit into human form, the gods and the goddesses. So at some point in the evolution, see, it started to take the way the people prayed. But it has to do with iron and bronze and all these things being starting to become mind. So it's like it kind of evolved in this kind of a way. It's like, see, in a way, religion emerged, but it was like a mining tool for the technologic reality that was manifesting itself through industrialization. But it became almost like a tool, see, because you got to go to the center of where the human being is, because all human beings want to know where we come from and where we're going, what's our purpose. So you've got to go there if you're going to mess with them. You have to go there to the very beginnings. The beginnings and the heart of the spiritual realities. So the God thing evolved, the religious thing, that changed the creation story from being a creation story to where there was a new story, and this new story was that there was a male dominator God removed from the earth who owned everything because he made it. So he owned it. All right, now, at this point, in our common collective genetic ancestral memory, every one of our relations back in that time rejected this. Because life worked for them. Because the earth was the mother and the sky was the father. It's like the great spirit. Spirits, everything, it worked for them. They maintained a balance. They knew who they were. They knew what their purpose was. They knew their relationship to power. They knew everything about their lives. So it worked for them. But they were forced to accept this other perceptional reality through violence and terror and aggression. Same thing happened to the Indians here by the descendants of the tribes of Europe, happened to the tribes of Europe and their descendants. That's why they behaved the way they did when they got here. And this is where I think sexism comes from. I think it comes from our relationship to the earth. See, I think sexism was one of the mining tools, because when you're going to convince all of the human beings in whatever tribes that they're in, as you come into contact with them, you had to turn them against the earth to promote this male god thing, to alter the perceptional reality. So this is where sexism came. It came as a way because, see, as long as the people considered themselves to be the children of the earth and a part of the earth, they would not plunder the earth. They would not aid and abet or accept the plundering of the earth, because the earth is their mother. See, so that's why sexism came in as a way, because in order to attack the earth amongst the human beings they came into contact with, they had to attack their perceptional reality about the woman in relationship to the earth and life. So sexism, so it was like a mining tool to help turn us against the earth and make the earth available for plunder. So in order to have all this experience get dumped down in our ancestral past, because it was all like what I'm saying is this mining process. As the technology grew, the ways and methods of mining remained the same. And it's almost like a predatory behavior. The behavior pattern never really changes itself. What the behavior pattern does is it just outlasts the generations. So after five generations are gone, the behavior pattern can be as predatory as it ever was, like medieval Europe. The behavior pattern can be as aggressive as it ever was, because after five generations, who's going to remember what was there? The terminology changes, the technology changes. So it's like there's this thing that just kind of been to me, right? That's a part of this civilization that just, it just kind of remanifests itself, but the continual thing is it eats our spirit to me, converts, feeds off of us in some kind of a way. See, so this is why it's important to separate everybody from any ancestral understandings and teachings, because see, they don't want anybody to know this. So everybody thinks they got hope. And the thing continues to spread, because you women, look at what the women's suffrage was in the 1800s. So now you have the right to vote and you made certain little gains, but see, it's still the same war. And the concessions are given very slowly. And it's this way with labor, it's this way with all of the things. But anyway, its behavior pattern basically remains the same. And its means of conducting its behavior pattern, that's what really changes. And the generation of people that it gets conducted on, this changes. But in order for all this stuff to happen, they have to neutralize our intelligence. They have to create a confusion in our own perceptional reality. So somewhere in each and every one of us, there's a collective genetic memory that goes way back to the beginning of the original dream, the beginning of our stories. And our relationship to power in reality is connected to us understanding that that is there. But we're in a technologic perception of reality that does not want us to understand that. The voice has said, Antichrist is anti-life. Greed, death's agents taking command. Society conditioned in death. Death to the air. Death to the water. Death to the future. Death in the mind. The voice has said, people strung out in confusion. Dancing at ends of industrial wires. Reactionary lives, reactionary minds. Forgetting who we are. Disguising servitude, fooling ourselves in lies of freedom. The voices said, industrial needs, human beings don't really matter. Their labor does. Energy consumed. Submission in many forms is submission not recognized. Material prisons, racial prisons, sexual prisons, chemical prisons, system prisons, angry prisons, slamming cell doors shut in human minds. The voices said, we are Earth's children. The people must stand strong. Our will is our life. Man, respect woman. Brother, help sister. Young, help old. Relative, help relative. Nation, help nation. The voices said, entering and leaving, we gather strength. When we know power, we are power. When we know peace, we are peace. When we know the time, we are the time. It's like severing our relationship to power is the objective. Our use of our intelligence, see, and our coherency. So all this cloudy is created, this illusion, because really it is. Crazy Horse said we live in the shadow of the real world, see, and we really, really do. Under the male dominator creator theory, see, all spiritual value really is removed away from the earth. So the earth isn't your mother anymore. The earth is the dominion and property of this new God, and you are to subdue it. See, that's like Martians landing. It really is, see, because it's a completely different perceptual reality. Going from caring for the earth, all right, to dominating the earth. And incidentally, you know, as a part of this process, see, you, incidentally, you created a moral crime for being born. So therefore, you have to listen to the authority of this new male God because you made a crime for being here. You see, before that was brought here, life was a gift. So when you were born, it was like an exchange of gifts, a gift to a gift. And even dying was like a gift because it was, once again, it was an exchange of life because we were part of a spiritual reality as physical beings. But anyway, this other thing, see, changed about there was something wrong with us for being born. See, and it's maybe a big thing, or see, to me, I think it's a major thing because, see, the first time that human being gets this, that they're guilty, all right, for being born, it alters their perception of self. It alters them from seeing themselves from the reality of who they are because they're picking up someone's illusion and they're viewing themselves through the illusion. And the way that that illusion seems to work, see, people don't learn from their guilt. They just make new guilts. See, so it, to me, in the end, it becomes a deal about irresponsibility. So even though all the words are being said, see, it's an irresponsible behavior. It's an irresponsible behavior because we are responsible for what we do. But when they condition us to feel guilty, and then we have to listen to their chain of command and be submissive to them, we are not taking responsibility. And we are not showing respect to our Creator, whoever it is, all right, for the gift of intelligence and life. Been hanging out down south of hell, playing to the music of a broken bell. Hard times and beating myself up inside my head. How was the walking wounded or the living dead? Tie a yellow ribbon around my brain. My mind booked, it's been gone so long. Rash traveling with mad and insane. Tears fell like tears, rain fell like rain. Shadow man called, catch me if you can. Knowing he can't be caught, he's the shadow man. Trickster turned free into junk and a rubber room. And junkie fix has even stolen from the moon. Leaders know they can't trust ones who follow. Followers know not to trust ones who lead. Love, hate, despair, and promises turn narcotic. If everything's normal, in reality, psychotic. Claiming to understand dimension and space, Babylon huffs and puffs, bullying around in the natural order, temptation rules in the valley of fools. Celestial cannibals feast on essence, the civilized hide out from their lives, the traumatized worry about everything, hypnotized worrying into nothing at all. Been hanging out down south of hell, playing to the music of a broken bell. Hard times and beating myself up inside my head. I was the walking wounded or the living dead. Now, intelligence, and all of this stuff happens through our intelligence. And just to have an example of how much of a relationship we have to power through our intelligence. Let's go into our own individual personal realities, the ones that nobody gets to see in. You know, and let's look at, okay, how much of this pollution, how much of my life is affected by my fears and my doubts and my paranoias and my insecurities, the things I hide from everybody but I can't hide from me even though I try. How much of my reality is affected by that? And then how much does that affect the realities of the people that I'm closest to. This is power. This is the power of our intelligence. And I define intelligence as our imagination, our creativity, our thoughts, and our actions upon these things. See, so however, whatever the answer is, however the negativity, the toxic, is working within our reality, whatever kind of power it has in the way our lives unfold, well, that's how we're using our imagination, our creativity, and our thoughts. Because we have been programmed and conditioned to use that, to use our intelligence in that manner. And mining takes place like, it's like sleight of mind. We're told, the more money we make, the more powerful we become. But that's not true, right? The more money we make, the more access to authority we have. But it has absolutely nothing to do with power, really. It's about authority. And in actuality, in the actual actuality, authority represents an absence of power. That's why it is needed. But we're told, or whoever has the biggest army, that makes them powerful. But it doesn't. It gives them violent access to authority. But as we go through our lives trying to seek our own personal self-empowerment and all of these kinds of terminologies and these things that we're looking for, we're not going to synchronize it if we call authority power, if we don't understand the certain reality, see, because we don't want authority. We don't want all of the money. We don't want all of the guns. See, so these are not things that we really want to have. But if we look at that as being power, then we do not see ourselves clearly as power. Because what I'm starting to get an understanding of, we live in a reality they don't want us to see clearly. They do not want us to see clearly. They do not want us to act coherently. And who is they? Just for lack of a better way, I'm just going to say, it's that industrial ruling class that is basically colonizing this planet. All right, and operating and creating a class of ethnic rich. Because when they talk about ethnics, you know, the smallest number are the rich. They are the minority in a majority system. The minority is the richest. So our relationship to power is connected to our relationship to the earth and the use of our intelligence. Because any clear, coherent thinking society, we would not live the way that we live today if this was a coherent, free thinking, clear thinking society. And I know that, and we all know that. We live this way because we have to accept certain things. See, but the biggest obstacle to me in getting after what we need to get after is in how clearly we see ourselves. Because again, to respect this about our intelligence and how about showing respect to our Creator, see, then we need to be real to ourselves. We should be able to face the reality of who we are no matter what it is we do in this reality. If there's any respect of the self, we owe it to ourself. If there's any respect, see, because all these things manifest. See, if it's weak at the heart, then it's going to be weak as you go out and as it goes out into the world. So we have to respect the self enough to be real to who we are. And it will help the synchronization of things in general in the long run. It truly will help. See, but if we have to hide from ourselves, then everything we do is going to be altered by that little alteration, our reality. The realities we seek or dream or chase, they're going to be altered because of that way. Because we're not concentrating and using the power of who we are, but we're altering it. See, so we should always be real to ourselves. We should always do this. Even if our truths are shameful or glorious, it doesn't matter. I'm not saying judge it. I'm saying face it. If it makes us uncomfortable and we can live with it, then fine. We're uncomfortable and we live with it. If it's something we can't handle, then fine. We can't handle it. And it all evolves through the behavior pattern. It evolves through our life. But we need to be real to ourselves. That is a part of our spiritual responsibility that never, ever goes away. It's coming back all the way back to the ancestral beginning, the collective genetic memory. See, that was a part of our responsibility, was to be real while we were here. And we have that ability. It's just that we have been mind manipulated in such a way See, that being part of human truly is being changed into a form of energy. See, and so it's got to do with how we think and how we use our intelligence. You know, because there are no solutions to any of the problems in front of us now, all right? There are only ways of dealing with them. But any solution, see, if we clear our individual and our collective intelligence and coherency and clarity, if we would set forth to clear, to make our intelligence clear and our perceptual reality a little bit more coherent, we set in that direction individually, collectively, then answers will come. We were born 18. If you think we're strange, you ought to see the others. We were born 18 in the middle of a Babylon dream. It's a crying shame is the name of the game. Learning how to ride out the storm. What did we take? What did we steal? What did we keep? What did we waste? We wandered with neon eyes among broken lights. Out of sync fantasies unbecoming to reality, turning over images for others to see. What we can't face looks for us anyway, breathing down our necks, these breaths of fire. We fought the cannibals, still nothing settled. With all these hungers to go around, masters of disguises, living double lives, hiding and smiling, we were born 18. Nothing we can do but conjure what we need. The work going on is the work going on. It's just more pyramids and slaves, wasting lives to the royal flush. Nothing new happening here. Nothing new. We were born 18. If you think we're strange, you ought to see the others. We were born 18 in the middle of a Babylon dream. It's a crying shame is the name of the game. Every word has power. Every word has power. And the power of every word is that every word has its own precise meaning. If you mean this and you use that word to mean this, then see, you're not, something's not synchronizing. Because every word has its own meaning. Because every word comes from somewhere. It's in here. It comes from the feeling, somewhere in this process, the feeling, the thought. See, in the feeling, that's how the being speaks to the human, is through feelings. And how the human handles how the feelings are. The human uses emotions to suppress the feelings or manipulate the feelings. But anyway, every word that comes out, at some point, it's coming from all of our centers. And we're turning it into sound, and we're tossing it into the world of vibration, the vibratory world of vibration of sound. It's like throwing a pebble in it. Pond, something happens. Now, believe is a word that I have a serious problem with, right? Because it's got a lie in the middle, B-E-L-I-E-V-E. So it makes me look at this word very, very carefully. See, I come from people who have beliefs, so I respect that. But, you know, it kind of drives me a little bit nutty. Just kind of just generally in the conversation that floats around in the society that we're in, how many times I hear, I believe. It does. It's, oh, man. See, and I don't mean any offense to anyone, see, but I'd be breathing a whole lot better if everybody was saying, I think. You know? I'd breathe a whole lot better. Because sometimes believe, number one, it's a passive word. It's not active. It's a passive word. It means we're not thinking. Because I think, again, when one looks at the mining process, when is it in our belief process, all right, that we stop thinking? You know, when is it that, well, I believe this, so I no longer really think about it? Or I pretend to think about it, but in my pretend thinking, what I'm really doing is I'm pretend thinking about it within the definitions and limitations of my belief. I'm not going outside and looking at this thing. I'm thinking about it within the limitations of my belief. See, in everything that was ever done to us, in our collective genetic ancestry, everything that was ever done to us was to make us believe them. Everything, to believe the way they wanted us to believe. Because that's the most intricate part of the mining thing, to get us to believe. Because if we don't believe them, they can't mine us. So they put every kind of confusion and clarity out there for us to believe. But it all emanates from them. And the way it all emanates from them is that we really have no value without them. But yet, I come from people who have beliefs. And I respect those beliefs because I'm, you know, I'm a product of those beliefs. But I'm saying we need to understand how we use the word when we use the word. And thinking, the gift of intelligence. We think our own misery and insecurity every damn day, and every one of us has a form of it, and I know that we do because it got us all. So when we're thinking like that, you know, and we're believing a lot of stuff that's negative about us and that is completely negative to reality, and we're being fed upon by our beliefs, it is in our best interest. Whatever our creator is that we say we respect and we pray to, it is in our best interest to respect the gift that that creator gave us, which is our lives, and it means that we use our intelligence to think a little more clearly, then that's what we need to do. Because about the thinking part, see, we can't stop. We never stop. Even when we sleep, we dream. We just don't, either we remember it or we don't, but it's always going. It just sometimes we're turned off to the process. See, so there's so much power in there, because everything that happened to us happened to alter our perceptional reality, and that's the basis of what happens today. So anyway, what ended up happening here, as it manifested itself, I live now in this century, whatever time frame we're in now, right, we're in it, and I look around and I see that I live in a society where the people feel powerless. They're angry, they're pissed off, they're frustrated, you know. There are a lot of things, but they feel powerless. And you can see it. You can see it in a calm collective psyche because they allow the lie. They just accept the lie, right? Vote and it'll get better. Yeah. Yes. Right? And see, what I'm saying, so, and I'm not trying to overthrow anything, but I want to say this about democracy. You know, there's a timeline here, and I don't know where I'm at on it, so I might be getting short. But I want to say it's about democracy, and I want to say it's about freedom. It's not about freedom, right? And I'm very careful of people and how they use the word freedom, because, you know, sometimes we use it, we're habitual users, you know? And a word like freedom, see, because to me, the lie that I see in freedom is if I believe in my freedom, that means I make the rules. So that means I have to accept everybody's deal of freedom. See, the racist has the freedom to be a racist. Like, I got the freedom to be a nut. Because if I get to decide freedom, then every human being has the right to make that decision for themselves. Otherwise, it's a lie. It keeps us from synchronizing all the things that we want to synchronize, like our intent and our consciousness and our motives, because we don't understand exactly what it means. See, it's about responsibility, I'm telling you. It's not about freedom or our rights. In some ways, on some lower level ways, it is. But in the reality, it's about our responsibility. We take our responsibility and exercise our responsibility, and we will be free, and our rightful place will be manifested. We want our responsibilities. We will take our responsibilities. See, then the whole issue of freedom and rights, that's going to get solved real quick. In an evolutionary reality, when we understand that it's about taking responsibility, then we will solve many of these problems at a much more accelerated rate. Because that's really what it's about, because they've got us chasing certain abstractions. But I know if I'm locked up in a cage, I want my freedom. See, I understand that. See, so some kind of a way, then there's ways maybe the word should be used, and we should be careful about the word, how we're using them. Because it's very central to how we get to participate in this reality. Us understanding that all the words have power, you know, it's like, and I'm not trying to trash on anybody's gods or anybody's belief, anything, right? And actually, I don't particularly want you to believe me. See, but if it's there and there's something to think about, that's what I want, is like to think about it. And a wisp of smoke down on the corner, there was this cat named Fortunate Lee. talking at me from voices in his head, yelling about what storyteller said. You've got to be careful here, child. There's a beast in the promised land. There's madness you don't understand. The beast is crazed and running wild. Little boy, man, little girl, woman, no big deal. Nothing personal. Your mind is another meal. Savoring the rush of you like heady wine. Feeding is what the beast is meant to do. Stranger, those walls built to hide. Stranger to look and learn not to see. He's in the mask you put on your face. Thought is his favorite breeding place. In the race to midnight, it's after 11. The nature of the beast is all he knows. Behind doors of hell are gates of heaven. The doors are open, but the gates are closed.